Queen look real?
Well, this is all to do with making the ruler look above the ordinary. So the Queen, if you look at Queen Victoria, yes. I mean, she was quite an elderly lady, but they made her look an empress, you know, yeah. Empress of India. If you look at my portrait of the Queen, she looks quite regal.
Yeah, she looks quite attractive.
Yes.
I suppose the history of that going back to the Greeks and Romans, I mean, specifically on coins, would have been to almost deify them.
Well, that's right, making them more like gods, really.
Yeah.
Just look over there. Just a minute. He hasn't got any particularly strong characteristics in his head, you know, in his portrait as such.
Have you noticed my nose?
I have noticed. I was just about to mention your elongated nose. Yeah. The nose is like, you know, is quite characteristic. I have to idealise him slightly and not make his nose sort of jut out so much and then with that big nostril. And you'll see it when the coin, when I eventually... But it'll still be him, but it'll be an idealised version of him. So I hope you don't mind that, but that's how...
No, I was a bit unsure about the big nostril comment. Just one of them.
Well, okay, at the moment...
Nostril is plural. Oh, you can only see one.
See one, sorry.
The idea of being made to look regal is I think, quite a challenge. I think it's the last thing I would say about myself. I can't imagine what Raphael's doing there or what the end product will be. But I totally love the idea of being on a coin, which has got to be ego. And I believe it's going into, it's going to be legal tender, yeah?
I'm afraid it won't, because we're not allowed to usurp the Queen's portrait.
I was told this was going to be currency for a year.
I've now completed the first phase, which is a rough sketch. Come and have a look.
Okay, here I go to look at it for the first time. Wow, that's great. I can definitely see myself. The main thing I notice is how you've changed my hair.
Your hairstyle?
Yeah, because
it's a bit too, you know, sticking up to be idealistic.
This won't be here on the day, will it? That's your subconscious at that.
It's a tall order turning me into a ruler, but sculptors have been changing who we are throughout history. Sculpted heads can make people into gods, and gods into people. And it was this perceived blasphemy that enraged Protestants during the English Reformation.
It's certainly very, very striking when you look at what's left from the image breaking of the 16th and 17th centuries. It's the head they go for. It's the head that's systematically chipped off. You go to the Lady Chapel of Ely Cathedral and you see every single head sliced off. Wherever they can reach, they've cut the heads off, even of the angels. And that, I think, is partly the sudden upsurge of this biblical literalism, which says no graven images. You can say, I think, in the Reformation period, that one of the greatest tributes to the emotional and spiritual power of statuary, medieval statuary, was the energy and ingenuity that went into defacing it. It's a recognition that there's power there. It's a power you don't want to have around. You can't be indifferent to it. You can't just ignore it. You've got to get rid of it.
In the Gloucestershire village of South Cerny, there's a significant survivor that escaped the rampant destruction of the Reformation.
The head was discovered by a church warden who was also a stonemason who did a lot of great work in this church. Why he actually chiselled into this point, I don't know, but this cross here marks the spot where he went through. And this is what they found. This is the oldest carved wooden cross in Great Britain. And we are immensely proud to have it in this church and for it to be found in this church. The head, it makes me feel very peaceful. I'm drawn to it quite a lot, obviously being the church warden and walking up and down here every day to the vestry. There's just something about it that does attract me to it, and I think it's that peacefulness and the beauty of it.
The Christian tradition is what it's most afraid of is that the token will be taken for the real thing. And that's why there's this injunction against graven images. But we can't do without them. In psychoanalysis, they're called transitional objects. These graven images, they are a means to an end. And of course, we imagine that to be really sophisticated and to be really civilized, we ought to be able to have a direct line to God himself without any intermediaries and so on. But of course, we can't manage it. So graven images are here to stay.
It's not just the English Protestants who turn their anger toward the head. It's been the symbol of countless revolutions worldwide.
45 years of hatred and rage as they jump up on the statue, trouncing it, taking their shoes off, smashing it to pieces. They're waving their fists in the air, they're chanting death to the damned.
There's something about a big head on the floor that makes you think of power being toppled. The Michael Jackson head is a kind of fallen colossus.
For Mark Quinn, the heads of celebrities echo emperors and pharaohs.
Celebrities are the new mythological creatures. We don't have gods and goddesses that everyone believes in, so we've kind of created this virtual pantheon. And to not engage with that, to me, seems like not engaging with an essential part of humanity. In a sense, the Michael Jackson head is a cult object. It's a god. And I think that's what's interesting to me about celebrity, is that it marks a time. You go to the British Museum and look at gods and goddesses, how many people really know who they are? It doesn't matter, it just is because they're convincing and they're of the moment. By using celebrities, I'm marking the moment these things are made in. It doesn't matter if no one knows who Michael Jackson or Kate Moss is in 1,000 years. It just gives it a reality for now.
Famous heads speak to everyone, and they talk to us in the sculpture of David Mack.
You have this huge recognition factor. It's like a three-way thing then. It's not just about Elvis, it's about Elvis and me. It's about Elvis and me and you. Yeah? And in Elvis's case, you is billions of people. It's a kind of a language, or even a currency or something. I mean, Marilyn, I mean, is she one of the most photographed women in the world? You know, it's something you'll see every day. I mean, I made my 9 Marilyns with matches. Matches are not something that you pay any attention to. It's not like you don't get home and then go, hey, wow, I found these amazing matches today. You know, they're a non-thing, they're a nothing thing. We burned one of the Marilyns in Paris. I was very worried about it. I thought it was just going to fall apart, but we had this amazing fire, and it was out in about 15 seconds. And lo and behold, because the matches have different colours of pigment on them, you get different colours of ash. So you still get the markings. You still get the Warhol markings on this head. And I didn't expect to get that at all. It's quite spooky. There's a kind of voodoo thing going on there, you know, when you get naked in a campfire or something like that.